Now, with all this notation and background behind us, we are ready for the Ford-Fulkerson method. As we'll see, it's not really specific enough to merit being called an algorithm, though sometimes we'll call it that anyway. We begin by initializing the flow to zero. Then, while there's a path from the source to the sink in the residual graph, we're going to calculate the minimum capacity along this path, we'll call that B, and then we're going to augment our flow where the augmenting flow has B along this path and zero everywhere else. Once there are no more paths in the residual graph, we just return the current flow that we found in this variable F. Let's see how this works on a toy example. We start with zero flow and the capacity is shown here. We find a path in the residual graph that looks like this. The minimum capacity is 1, so we'll add that value to every edge along the path in our original flow. The result is a new flow and a new residual graph. Here, there's only one ST path, so we'll go ahead and choose that. Adding it to the old flow will cause this flow across the middle to cancel out, leaving us with this flow and this residual network. At this point, there are no ST paths in the residual graph, so we're done. Great. And it's easy to confirm that the algorithm worked in this case. But how about in general? First, it's easy to verify that F is indeed a flow. Zero is a flow at the beginning, and at each iteration, we augment the current flow by a flow in the residual graph, and as argued earlier, this is indeed a flow. Does the algorithm terminate? Well, remember that the capacities are all integral, so each augmenting flow, F prime, has to have a value of at least 1. Otherwise, the path wouldn't be in the graph. Therefore, we can't have more iterations than the maximum value for a flow. So yes, it terminates. How much time does it spend per iteration? Finding a path can be done with breadth-first search or depth-first search in time proportional to the number of edges. Constructing the residual graph itself takes time proportional to the number of edges, and the number of edges in the residual graph is at most twice the number of edges in the original graph, since we only possibly created those reverse edges. And of course, updating the flow requires a constant amount of arithmetic per edge. So all in all, then, we just have order e time for each iteration, that is time proportional to the number of edges. This is a good start for the analysis, but it leaves us with some unanswered questions. Most important, perhaps, is whether the return flow is a maximum flow. Sure, it's maximal in the sense that we can't augment it any further, but how do we know that with a different set of augmenting paths, or perhaps with an entirely different strategy altogether, we wouldn't have ended up with a greater flow? Also, this bound on the number of iterations is potentially exponential in the size of the input, leaving us with an exponential algorithm. Perhaps there's some way to improve either the analysis or the algorithm to get a better running time. These two questions will occupy the remainder of the lesson. We'll start by showing that Ford-Fulkerson does indeed produce a maximum flow, and then we'll see about improving its running time.